I'm willing to put, you know,
all right,
he did his research.
You're a tight bro with a tight fro.
Yes, I was.
A tight bro with a tight fro.
My nickname was Horse and Buck, depending on who was calling me my nickname.
All right. We'll roll with that. Now let's talk a little bit about the Kill Tony stuff. Kill Tony must die. He's predatory. The format is predatorial. Now, he's not saying Tony Hinchcliffe must die, and I just want to make that clear. He's not calling for violence. He's saying the format of the show is not good for comedians or not good for comedy. Anybody with an opinion on that? Steven, you got an opinion on that? Ron, you got an opinion on that? GD doesn't care.
I agree.
First of all, I agree that GD doesn't care, and I agree that format is terrible.
Okay.
So, I agree. I'm on both ends of this spectrum as far as my views on Kill Tony, right? Do I think that Kill Tony does offer a small opportunity to anyone that shows up and can get on? Sure. You have that very, very slim chance, just as much as winning a small lottery, right? But at the same time, they pride themselves on, I mean, he asks at the beginning of the show, do you like when people do good on this show or do you like when they do bad? And they unanimously over cheer for they like when people do bad because they like to see people get ripped apart. So is it predatory? Absolutely, 100%. Do people know that going into it, though? 100% they do.
Right.
So
it's kind of self-inflicted. Let me stop you on that point. People know it going into it, and a lot of people who are not really serious about comedy are taking whatever possible opportunity away from people who are serious about comedy because they don't go in there with the gong show attitude. I'm going on to get gonged. I'm going on to be humiliated. And yeah. So it's whatever small opportunity was there in the first place is getting taken up by guys who are really not serious about comedy. Well,
you're not wrong, but I mean, you kind of face that even at like a regular open mic. You might have a group of college kids show up that just signed up to say, hey, fuck it, I'm going to try it and see how stupid I can look, you know? So you kind of run into that anyway.
That doesn't happen that often. Well, maybe in Indiana, because I don't know how stupid
Indiana's a college state, man. We have like 72 colleges. Like,
all right.
Now, you got a bunch of stupid people.
Ron Kane typically is being very quiet on this. I want to get his opinion on this stuff because he's a elder statesman of the of the comedy world, I think, right? You've been in longer than anybody else on the panel.
No, I've been doing it for about 6 years, almost seven.
I think we're tied. Oh, yes.
GD's the elder statesman then. Yeah, you're the second elder statesman out of the three. But let's hear your opinion on this. Do you have an opinion on this at all, or you don't care?
No. The thing with Kill Tony is I think it's, for me now, when I see it, it definitely shows that I feel that comedy is oversaturated. And to me, the show has kind of like firmly jumped the shark. It's basically the American Idol of the comedy world. Because you can get on there and parlay, and if you do well, you can parlay that into whatever. And there's some people on there that really have no business still to be out there like touring and things like that, but they are because they've been able to parlay that from showing up on that show. So,
Richard Francis Williams breaks it down to the numbers of how many people have actually done that compared to now in American Idol every year. And I'm not a big fan of Idol either, but I'm going to put this out there that every year, at least three of those people have a career launched, big time career launched because of that. And that's every year. And that's every year they have two or three people who make a major step up. And American Idol supports that in every way. And they fund them. They give them money for coaching and from the best professionals around. They are truly supportive and want those people to go on and succeed. Whereas Kill Tony gives you nothing. If you win, you get a bigger book than the loser gets.
And so, what about
let me finish one more point on that. They've had almost 5,000 guests, maybe a handful, 5-10 have gotten a career out of it. So that's a huge difference than Idol.
No, American Idol is the same way, because what American Idol winner do you know?
I don't really follow television, but I can tell you they've had some real success.
Yeah,
Ruben Studdard, Kelly, what's her face?
Carson.
No.
Ten years ago. Ten years?
But they've gotten record deals out of it and big money out of it. And you know what? I don't follow the pop world, but I know they have gotten record contracts with real money out of it.
They may have gotten record contracts, but none of them are really doing well. And we all know, like, the record contracts, especially for somebody coming off a TV show, is just going to be shitty. That's going to be a shitty contract.
Well, it's not always with American Idol. I mean, I'm not a watcher of it. I do know that in some regards, not the winners, but like people who came in second and third wind up with
the deals
because especially when people go like, oh hell no, you know who should have won? The girl with the golden dress, that she should have won.
Right. And Catherine McPherson, I think, placed 10th in her year. She just sold out two theaters here on Long Island. And that was 10, 15 years ago that she did that. Yeah. And she's still selling out theaters here. So, you know what? People do get careers out of them. And now I'm not defending an idol. I'm just saying it's much better than the odds of getting a career out of. No. You know, William Montgomery is the biggest fucking star that came out of Kill Tony. And what's he doing? He's still
My Three Sons. Yeah. Isn't he doing My Three Sons?
You got David Lucas and like Casey Rocket now.
Well, you have
Hans Kim.
You have the German dude.
Hans Kim, the German dude. Richard Francis Williams points out Hans Kim has confessed on a podcast he's made not $1 from anything that he's done related to Tony Hinsa.
Well, yeah, I'm sure. And if you dig into Idol, it's not that. What I'm just saying is, like, comparison to me, that they're essentially almost the same show, except one takes place in music and one takes place in comedy. So when I, like, see Kill Tony now and, like, the bigger things they're doing, it's like, okay, like, I get that. But at the same time, it feels just, like, very American Idol to me. Because especially when American Idol started and then they kept going, what did American Idol capitalize on? And that was the people coming on the show and doing horrific. And almost it became its own bit where people would get on there. It's like, oh, sing me this song. And they would just get on there and it was horrible. But they still got their like minute of fame and they would get ripped apart.
Oh, you mean like William Hung?
Yes. Yeah, he's an example of that. Yeah.
William Hung, I kind of
eventually went into porn with a name like that.
He does comedy now. He does comedy shows.
I definitely understand that the mentality of what the public wants. But I do think there is a big difference because Steven brought up that the audience wants people to suck on Kill Tony so that Joe Rogan and Brian Redband and all those people on there can just make fun of those people. I think with Idol, they definitely have everybody on there has fans that want to see them do well. And nobody is going, I hope these singers really suck.
But in the early state, yeah, when every season they start out, people do want people to suck because that's part of the fun. And occasionally
at the audition stuff, but not the people that make it up to the stage for the competition.
No, but then again, I feel like those, you know, like Steven said, those people are going up there on their own volition and you know what's in store. But then too, when someone gets up there and they kill it, it's great because especially if they, you know, they're doing it in a minute's time, it's good to see.
And there's also with Kill Tony, there's different levels, I guess, of success in that show too. Not just the golden ticket winners, but you have like the bucket pulls that do well and also do a good interview that they'll be like, hey, come back when you have more material, come back when you've developed some. And it's weird because sometimes Tony Hinchcliffe looks like he's really trying to help and mentor here and there, and then the rest of the time it just looks like he's just shitting on people to shit on people. So it's
I'll be honest, I have not watched enough of it to ever experience Tony being a positive force for people. Every time
it's a handful, like, it's not a lot, but I've seen probably 30 episodes of it, and it's happened a few times, not often, but it happens.
I saw one episode, but I saw it four times because it was a friend of mine that was on there, and they ripped her a new one.
Right.
They were really, really mean to her.
The other part,
and they set her up to be mean. They set her up to be mean to her.
Right. Now, again, I'm not defending Idol or America's Got Talent or any of these things, but they do provide coaches and supportive people to help you get better at your career. Tony Hinchcliffe and those people are the first people to complain about the people getting taken advantage of in comedy, and they don't pay anything. The loser gets a small book, the winner gets a bigger book, and then never a penny in compensation. They're making millions of dollars off the show.
How much can you get for the book?
30 cents.
And then again, though, that's kind of like Idol, because yeah, you're going on there, but they're making all sorts of money from you being on there, from the advertising. So, and they're using your picture.
They do get paid, and they do get coaching. They get positive coaching from world-class professionals, you know, record industry people who are working with them. You don't get any of that support at all with Kill Tony. I compare Kill Tony to the modern day Gong Show. And listen, I love Chuck Barris, but that was predatory. It was clearly, you know, just there to make money and humiliate people.
But and also, in all fairness, the Gong Show is also there as a cover for Chuck Barris because he was a spy.
That's true.
And so not he
true.
Needed a cover.
It's not true. That's a true claim. But yeah,
no, I think you fall in prey to the Mandela. What's that called? The Mandela mime?
Yeah,
Mandela thing.
I would like you guys to hold on to your defensive, your attitude of defensiveness towards Tony Hinchcliffe, not Tony the person, the Kill Tony Show, because I want to get Richard Williams on here, and I want you to make the same arguments you're making to me right now to him, and see how that goes.
Okay,
because I think it would help if you actually checked out the video that he puts out there. He kind of lays out the numbers. Now he fucks up on the decimal point, but he's being very consistent, conservative in his numbers of how many people have been on the show versus how many people have gotten opportunities from being on the show. It's pretty wild. It's smaller than winning the lottery. And
yeah, I kind of agree with what you're saying, but at the same time, that's like any of those entertainment shows. They're all feeding anything that they take advantage. I mean, it's the entertainment industry. The whole industry is based on taking advantage of people because
let's see what some of these people are saying.
Because you can always get someone to do it cheaper.
Rappler says, I've been watching Kill Tony since the Iron Patriot days when the show was in the belly room at the Comedy Store, and the move to Rogan's Club has made it considerably more insufferable for a variety of reasons. I would love to hear what those reasons are.
That's what I was about to ask. What are the reasons? Because I don't know anything about Kill Tony.
I've only talked to two people that's ever been there in person, but I've heard okay things about the mothership, but...
Well, from when I was down in Austin, the big thing you hear is because of the mothership, then Red Band owns Sunset. Like a lot of those clubs and everything are, you know, owned by the Rogan guys. So it's like one, you know, it's like kind of like one directive in a lot of those clubs around there. Not everybody, but in certain clubs. And I've heard that from comics on the scene in Austin.
Yeah, a big part of, and you know, it's a shame that Willie, his Wi-Fi is all of the equipment issues and isn't working. Because I would love to talk to him about this, because I do think part of the, and this is definitely true of Idol and America's Got Talent and all this stuff. It feeds into this wrong attitude that all I need is this one home run and I'm going to be set for life, rather than putting in the work. And I think it's bad for comedians to get that attitude in mind, to think I'm just going to line up, go to Kill Tony every day, hope I get on the every week, hope I get on the show, and that's going to be my ticket to stardom. And then so many people get disappointed by that. I think it's a really bad paradigm for people to get caught up in, rather than I'm gonna work, I'm gonna go out there and do as many shows as I can, open mic nights, any night I can, get as many shots at perfecting my craft, rather than I'm ready for this. I'm ready for stardom. The world just needs to see me because I'm fucking great, man. If they see me for 1 minute, that's it. I'm going to write my ticket and buy a mansion in Beverly Hills and be made it. And I think that feeds into that really bad attitude that a lot of people have. And absolutely, America's Got Talent and Idol fill that too.
And you can also make that same argument about TikTok and Instagram and things and YouTube.
Yeah.
It's the same thing. If you're just making videos like everyone just needs to see me.
I think you're valid. That's a valid point. There is some difference there in that you can do plenty. You can put out a lot of material so that people can judge a body of work with your social media efforts and all that stuff. But yeah, it is looking to make a home run pretty quick. They don't do road shows anymore, which is where the really golden ticket winners were discovered. Road shows, meaning like do Kill Tony in New York and do to Kill Tony in another place, I guess. And perhaps most of all, the show has gotten more successful. The fan base has gotten, shittier. The people have gotten exponentially shittier.
Yeah. And when people get, you know, they have a viral hit and, you know, it does really good for them, then like the next videos you see, they're like, they have their own t-shirts and they're trying to hawk, hats and everything else.
That's why I've been tearing up the road for a decade to earn my stripes and pay my dues. Well, congratulations, Andy. Well, I think that's the way to do it. Listen, I'm an old school hard ass, but I believe in learning your craft by doing and doing it over and over again. And I think the people who just get lightning in a bottle, sometimes they're not ready for it. Most of the time they're not ready for it. Very few times they are ready for it at a young age and can sustain a career off of. Yeah. Now, again, I wish Willie was here because I know William Montgomery rubs him the wrong way. And he feels like, that guy's getting
old. That's a sexual thing, isn't it?
I mean, that dude is.
Rub him the right way, right? With the little practice.
No, I know.
Rub and tug.
Yeah, yeah, I know. I know a comic that's had interactions with William Montgomery, and he didn't have good things to say.
Yeah, well, I think
if his personality is anything like his stage persona, I would probably stab him in the throat with a rusty spoon.
Yeah.
Wow. So he's an actual comedian.
Does it have to be rusty?
Just for my sake, just for my pleasure, I want it to. Right. I want it to fester.
And you
I don't think he's particularly talented at all, and I don't think he's a guy who. Now, because Brett Erickson, I consider a friend, is on his show. He's the Ed McMahon on the William Montgomery Show, so I know him. He's going to be angry with me for saying this, but I don't think William Montgomery has ever really displayed any real skill as a comedian or a. Talent is a tough, that's an objective, but skill, definitely. I don't think he's worked it enough to get famous. And I think if you get famous for having no skill, you're kind of a laughing stock. And for whatever, whatever money he makes off it, it's still at the expense of his reputation, his personality. It's, it's not good.
The thing I'm curious about is I don't think I've met anyone yet that's been to like a show from one of those guys from Kill Tony as like someone going to their show and checking out their headlining act, because I would be curious about some of that. And I've seen some of the David Lucas stuff float out there online, kind of like when he walked 20 some or 40 some people in a show. It was bad because it looked like this is just an open micer on stage. They cannot handle it when it looked rough.
Right. Rappler has a conspiracy theory that I got to admit, it's a good one.
It makes sense. It makes sense.
He says for the people on the radio side, says, I'm convinced William Montgomery is a Trading Places style bet Tony made with Redman. I bet I can make people think this guy is hilarious. That just feels true. It has like, a ring of extreme truthiness to it.
Like when he comes on, when the dude comes on stage, there's times when he'll say something, it'll catch you and it'll make you laugh for a second because it's just so off the wall and off the cuff. But then you're just like, okay, this dude's just screaming at people.
Oh, he's tight with Sam Talent. I did not know that. I never even talked to Sam about him. That's interesting.
Well, some of these guys like Sam Talent have gone on record saying that behind the scenes that William Montgomery is a super chill, really nice dude. So
I could believe that he's a nice dude.
I can believe he's a good person too. It's just like I said, if his stage persona is his real personality, that'd be too much.
Yeah. But coming back to Rappler's conspiracy theory there, that's the kind of stuff that Tony Hinchcliffe gravitates to. He's a big-time wrestling fan and loves that kind of theater and drama and, you know, cartoonish setup. So it just feels like he's on. I've never heard anybody say that before, but now that he said it, I'm not going to let that go because it's in my mind big time. Every time I see William Montgomery, I'm going to think, you realize you're the stooge in Tony Hinchcliffe's drama that he's created here. Very weird. Anyway, I guess we can move on from the stuff. But I find it interesting. And this Richard, all these guys who have three names, I always think they're like Lee Harvey Oswald, Richard Francis Williams. Can't we just all have just two names? It's like people have one name. They're awfully pretentious. Cher,
Beyonce,
Madonna, Beyonce. Those people with one name, they're really pretentious, and the people with three names are really creepy. I think. Why can't we all just have? Well, Steven the sitcom Ortiz is pretty creepy. He might be a serial killer.
I think that's why you need three names. I think that's why you need three names so you can identify the serial killer. Because when they identify the serial killer, they use all three names just in case there's like another Lee Harvey.
Yeah, you know, like John Wayne Gacy or Lee Harvey Oswald. Now,
I think this is wrong. I know Sam started in Denver. Sam's a Colorado native. I'm pretty sure William Montgomery started in St. Louis, Missouri, where he's from. Now I've been wrong about stuff before, and there's probably 99.9% chance I'm wrong about this. But I feel pretty sure.
You're going to stick with it.
I'm going to stick with it. It's my final answer. Do we have like a final answer type of thing, like a multiple choice where I can call?
Can I phone a friend? Can I get a friend and then get his phone number?
Can I get a friend and then can I call a friend? Well, a friend that will give me the number that I can call. I would like that. We're an hour in. Want to hear the news? Yeah, of course you want to hear the news because I paid for the news.
Sure.
Yeah. I paid for the news, so you guys are excited to hear more about
please,
the news,
yeah. Right? Maybe we have some more, please.
Yeah.
Donald Trump's legal team says it tried serving Stormy Daniels a subpoena as she arrived erotic. For an event at a bar in Brooklyn last month. But the porn actor, who is expected to be a witness at the former president's criminal trial, refused to take it and walked away.
A process server working for Trump's lawyers said he approached Daniels with papers demanding information related to a documentary recently released about her life and involvement with Trump, but was forced to leave them at her feet, according to a court filing made public. Liam White reporting.
The Solomon Islands' closer relationship with China and a troubled domestic economy weighed on voters' minds as they casted their ballots.
As many as 420,000 registered voters had their say across 50 national seats. For the first time, the national vote also coincided with elections for 8 of the 10 local governments. Opposition candidates have campaigned on re-examining elements of the Chinese relationship, including the 2022 security pact with Beijing, as a key issue for the electorate. Jessica Oakley reporting.
Group of seven foreign ministers met on the Italian resort island with the agenda topped by calls for targeted new sanctions against Iran over its attack against Israel and more aid to Ukraine to fight Russia's war.
Under Italy's stewardship of the rotating presidency, the G7 leaders issued a united call for Israel to exercise restraint after Iran's unprecedented weekend attack involving hundreds of drones, ballistic missiles and cruise missiles fired toward the Jewish state. The ministers emphasized the need for concerted international action to hold Iran accountable. Benjamin Wright reporting.
Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu said his country would be the one to decide whether and how to respond to Iran's major air assault earlier this week, brushing off calls for restraint from close allies.
Israel will decide for itself how to respond to the Iranian attack, Netanyahu stated firmly, dismissing pleas from international partners to exercise caution. The region remains on edge, bracing for potential further escalation after months of unrest linked to the ongoing conflict in Gaza. Joseph Eckerson reporting.
Joseph Eckerson.
This is the latest news headlines.
This war. Don't be fooled with that again.
Ford is recalling more than 456,000 Bronco Sport and Maverick vehicles due to a battery detection issue that can result in loss of drive power, increasing crash risks.
According to documents published by the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration,
powertrain
control modules for these cars may fail to detect changes in battery charge. When undetected, a low battery charge can cause an unexpected loss of drive power, including sudden stalling or inability to restart. Lawrence Keller reporting.
The New York State Legislature's bill drafting office was hit with an apparent cyber attack, officials said.
The scope of the attack was not immediately clear, but officials said the bill drafting system has been down since early Wednesday. The office is responsible for printing legislation for lawmakers at the state capitol in Albany. The apparent cyber attack came as the legislature is moving to finalize its state budget bills. Kevin Sanders reporting.
A Minnesota toddler who fell from a South Dakota hotel's third floor window has died.
Catherine and Alex Hine of Lakefield, Minnesota, wrote in a Facebook post that their year-old son Madden died Monday, 2 days after falling at Clubhouse Hotel and Suites in Sioux Falls. It is with heavy hearts to say that our sweet baby boy Madden gained his angel wings late on April 15th, the couple wrote. Police are investigating the boy's death. Jim Kender reporting.
A man was sentenced to 47 years to life in prison for kidnapping and sexually assaulting a nine-year-old girl who went missing from a state park in upstate New York last year.
Craig N. Ross Jr. pleaded guilty in February to taking the girl in September from a campground at Morrow Lake State Park, a rural area about 35 miles north of Albany. The disappearance sparked a 48-hour search that ended when she was found alive at a camper Ross was staying in. Paul Gomez reporting.
And that's the latest news headlines with Alan Edwards.
DJ, I just want to say you could just like give me a signal not to steal your joke. You don't have to jump in the middle. Because that was, to be honest with you, I probably would have jumped on that Madden Falls, renaming Sioux Falls to Madden Falls now. But you could have had that joke to yourself. You could have the patience enough to wait. Don't anybody steal this. I got this. Or something.
That's not how comedy works.
Oh, okay.
Or snarky comments.
Yeah, no. Wasn't Eric Clapton's kid named something like Madden too? The kid that fell from the window. I don't know. I've only had angel wings before the accident, yeah. See, now that was his alone and very good one. Maybe we should get him on the show.
Very good. That was good. Good job, Evil Ian. That was evil. Good job.
Yeah, very good. Well, wow.
You know the best thing about that? Ian didn't have to, he put it out there. He didn't have to say it, and so he won't get dinged. He won't be known as the bastard that said it. But we read it out loud, so it's like, we're the bastards that put it out there.
It's not nice to make fun of a dead baby.
No, it's not.
It's not.
It's a little premature.
I don't think so.
Never mind.
We need to alleviate the trauma and stress from it in some way. And laughter. Hey, listen, it's not your baby. If it were your baby, we would not be making a joke about it.
No, I wear condoms. You can talk about all the condom jokes you want to about my condoms that fell off the off the balcony.
Now. Oh, isn't it time, because they said police are still investigating. This is like a year later, right? Or it didn't happen, like the fall didn't happen recently. The kid died recently.
Well, they said they died a couple of days afterwards. So maybe they're, okay, they probably have to question the balcony, you know, see what the balcony was doing this. You know,
like, if you're a parent and your kid falls out a window, somebody is negligent. Somebody wasn't watching.
Yeah,
the
somebody
kid close enough.
Exactly.
Yeah, I could see if it was a Russian baby because that happens. All Russia is just known for babies and things falling out of windows. But in the U.S., we don't. That's not our thing. We're like stairs.
You think this kid said something bad about Putin? Is that what you're trying to?
If it was a Russian,
he had some info on. He had some info on Clinton.
Yeah, what state was this again? State of denial. What state was
Iowa.
This? State of neglect.
Sioux Falls, man. It's Willie's hometown.
Yeah, state of neglect. That's right.
Yeah.
That's where I'll be in June with Willie.
So, yeah, the parents are definitely, I think, need to be charged with something.
Dude, listen, I got three kids.
It's suffering enough, but they're not obviously not enjoying this suffering. Maybe they should tune in and we can help them enjoy the suffering.
They're probably going to have a peaceful night's sleep.
Yeah.
For once.
Now, if we can let the kid rest in peace while his parents should, I don't know. They're probably distraught and traumatized enough by this and feel terrible.
They're probably going to get divorced within the next year.
That's probably true. I would.
On the other hand, she's a catcher. She's a catcher.
Can we get a line on mybookie.com about that? Like, because there is a high probability of that, right? Probably odd.
I think we should post their pictures to see how they would do. See, take money.
Probably have to lay down like $50 to win $10 or something like that.
But, are we gonna? Yeah, so true. we gotta find their dating profiles.
We could see bet on who replaces their other mate first.
Yeah.
Who finds a replacement first? That's what we could bet on.
Right.
Too bad my bookie's not a sponsor. Still, we could use them.
Yeah. Now Stormy refused to take it. That's probably the first time she refused to take it, but she insisted they lay it at her feet, which is kind of weird for a porn
star. Yeah, they said they were forced to put it at her feet. Yeah. If they had paid her, she'd have taken it, because that's what it is. She takes it for money. Yeah, you know, you just don't give her a subpoena. That's like
kind of expensive. I think the going rate is like $130,000 for a fucking blow.
Yeah. See, they were like rape. They were trying to force her to take it.
I don't know what she charges for footwork or whatever you call that, foot play, foot something. But it's probably at least $10,000, don't you think?
Football. I think it's called football.
Yeah. But
soccer.
I think most people, if you're approached by a process server in public, most people are going to say, no, I ain't taking that, right? Am I wrong? If you're approached by a process server around all the time, I know this. Let's just say you're doing your little comedy shtick there, and you get off stage, and somebody says, Ron Kane, and they go to hand you an envelope. You taking it?
Well, first of all, Ron will probably sign it and give it back to him like it's an autograph.
I mean, I guess I would, but I don't even know if I would read it, because I'd be like, I don't care. I know, I'm so bad at things like that where it's supposed to be important. I'm like, I don't care. Just tell me.
I know. I'm the same way, man. I have not. I look like a year later and like, oh, I guess I should open this jury duty letter that I got a year ago.
Well, I'm going to tell you, Ron is such a prima donna, though, that if they gave him and said, Ron, you've been served, he would go, this is not my beer, and throw it off. Throw it away.
Yeah, I don't like things handed to me.
We got 4 minutes for our guests to show up here before I declare him a no-show. And you know what? Maybe he heard that I'm going to give him a hard time about his website not being readable. And
well, maybe, you know, so I'm willing to bet that his website and his emails are set up the same way. So you sent him an email and it showed up with the same lack of contrast. He couldn't read it.
I got my settings all wrong. Damn it.
Well, on the first page of his webpage, it has in big blue bold letters his talking points about all these articles that they lead to, and I can read you some of them, and we'll be happy if he shows up, and if he doesn't, I'll probably still read them anyway. But so those are very readable. It's just once you get into the content that it becomes unreadable. Moving on this news commentary, China and the vote. They have people voting in China. Is there any chance that those voting in China is not corrupt and just a fucking show?
It is corrupt, but it's mandatory.
Mandatory show.
It's a mandatory show. Why? Why not? Why? See, this is in the old days. Old school dictators would just say, "Fuck it. It's just how I say it's going. We're not going to have a vote," and they would move on. Now because you have to fake it.
Because then Uncle Sam comes knocking at your door saying, hey, we got some freedom for you. But now they can put up this illusion of, a democratic thing and look like that they're doing the right thing. But in reality, we all know they're not, but we're not going to say anything because they make everything for us.
I think everybody knows that Uncle Sam's word is shit, though. I mean, look at Netanyahu. Benny, don't send missiles. Okay, I'm sending missiles anyway. Fuck you. I mean, so nobody cares what the U.S. says, right? Am I right? Am I wrong? I'm just
well. They need pretend elections because since China is like us, they're whores. They like money as well, and China has this emerging middle class, and now they have this huge middle class that have means to buy things, and they have to appease them. And China's always walking that line between communism and capitalism because they want the money.
Yeah. And this idea of middle class is totally against us. Yeah, communism and middle class are like self-exclusionary. I mean, there should be no middle class in communism. It should be just the elites and the proletariats and whatever. So yeah, I just think that, you know, why have a vote if it's all, you know, it's like wrestling. It's like fucking professional wrestling. The vote is scripted, right?
It's like a household where you have a parent and nine kids, and the two parents say, where y'all want to go for a vacation? And the nine kids raise their hand and say, we want to go to Disney. And then the parents raise their two hands and say, no, we're going to Dairy Queen.
Right. Well, I'm glad you brought up vacation.
And it's just like here, you know, because our election was fake. Our election was fake a few years ago, so we're just keeping things going, you know.
Yeah, we're just joining the club, you know. It's just we just decide what happens and then make it happen. It's, you know,
the Ron, votes are just you're in black show. And white today, so the red on your hat is not showing clear. But
we all know that Mike Pence should have been president. That's
okay. That's I live in Indiana. In I'll tell you right today, now. Hell no.
You're for some reason you're in black and white, which I don't mind.
Actually, depending on where he moves, sometimes his cheeks turn pink.
If yeah, I know you do a good, I don't know if people are aware of this, but Ron actually does a RFQ impersonation, but I'm not going to ask about that now because we've had RFQ on the show this morning, and I'm wondering how he feels about that. But it being in black and white, maybe you should work on like a Rod Serling impersonation or something like that. Because
there we go. That's come better. On black,
yeah.
So Ron is performing.
But now you're invisible. You can do, now you can do a Claude Rains impersonation. Wow, it's really good.
Look, he looks like my dad.
He's doing his Harvey impersonation.
Oh, never mind. He's back.
he looks like my dad. Oh, never mind. He's back. What a bum. Italy, the G7 thing.
Whoa, Rod, stop. I've had nightmares like this.
Now you're uplighting the beard and all.
This is Robert Kennedy Jr. I am your God.
This is what Stormy Daniels gets off to now.
Right. G7, they're just going to Italy to a resort island. It kind of feels like these guys aren't really, they're just in it for the free vacations, right?
You got
to
remember,
they're the reptilian puppets, so they get to go on vacation while the reptilians are still ruling the world.
I want to be in a G7. All I can get is a GD. I want to be in a G7.
I used to drive a G6.
The other thing I wanted to talk about the Ford battery thing, and we're short on time here. The guest is in the back room here, and I want to play a commercial before we bring him in. But the New York State cyber attack, I think we're going to just start seeing more and more of this shit. Now, I don't know if it's just the, like, kids, you know, teenagers in their mom's basement with a really good laptop playing games on the government, or it's like a serious thing. But
Willie trying to get back into the show.
Well,
Willie can't even hack into.
Well, the thing is, with these attacks, though, it's they're gonna obviously. I think they're gonna be real careful to call it a foreign attack because it would be an attack. So. Yeah. They're going to do anything
New York
they can
State,
to make it
right. A foreign attack, maybe they would, but I would think a
as a test run or something, maybe. But I mean, it's at this point, I think we're just going to start seeing more and more. I mean, that's where we're heading is digital warfare.
If it were China, I think they'd start with Texas. Wouldn't they start with Texas? I would start with Texas before New York.
Maybe we can just offer up Florida for them to experiment on and leave the rest of us alone.
All right.
That's the sticky wicket. Like Chinese can They can attack us, but it's in their best interest not to attack us because we're their biggest customer and they need us. You think
why China, the government doesn't really do it. They have like fourth and fifth parties do it and they don't stop them. And then they report the results to the
fourth and fifth parties.
No.
Well, I'm glad that's a good segue because we have somebody coming on who is not a third party. He's a fourth or fifth party. He's not a party. He's a party, a political party that's not a political party. It's called the Solutions Party. And we'll talk to him.
It's called the Final Solutions Party? Is that what it's called?
The Final Solutions Party. If I were in New York or L.A., I'd be taking cover right now.
Because the other Solutions parties, this is the last one. They don't need anyone after this one.
Yeah, it's very sticky wicket you just brought up there, Ron. Thank you very much. Now I'm feeling totally
uncomfortable at all.
Yeah. Anyway,
I belong to the emotions party as opposed to
enjoy the suffering.
The problems party rather than the solutions party. We'll talk about all this in a minute with our guest Evan Aqua.
I think it's Evan J. Aqua. I think it's Evan J. Water.
Jaqua.
Yeah, I think Jay is his middle name.
Anyway, this segment is brought to you by Daily High Club. Of course it is.
Daily
High Club, best place to get everything you need except the weed.
Daily High Club helps me stay stoned all the time. I get everything I need to enjoy my weed. I love to get nice sucking on a big hard bong. What are you waiting for? The link is in the description. With over 1 million top quality smoking products sold, and with a growing base of over 10,000 monthly subscribers worldwide, we deliver the ultimate smoking experience. Did I mention that I like to fuck when I'm stoned? Click me now, baby.
No, she didn't just say that, did she? We're off the air. That's it. Final show.